Okay, a lot of you people watching are on my list. You're real estate investors or in the real estate business. So we're talking about some common misconceptions that people have about real estate and real estate investing. The first one is, this is a real pet peeve of mine. It's a quit claim deed. Q-U-I-T, not a quick, Q-U-I-C-K. Not quick, like we do it quickly. It's quit. Quit claim means you're giving up any claim to the property. You're not promising any warranties. You're not promising there's no liens. You're not promising there's good title. You're just quitting or giving up any claim that you have to the property. Very simple. Okay, quit claim deed. All right. Number two, common misconception is that if someone, you're under contract and it says you're supposed to close by a certain date and you don't close, but you get an oral phone call or even a loose email that says, yeah, we'll just extend the contract. That's not enforceable. All contracts for the sale of real estate must be in writing, including addendums. So those of you who are brokers especially, make sure you get those what's called amend and extend, and make sure that you get those things in writing. Now, sometimes an email can be a writing, but read the contract carefully. If the contract says that all changes to this contract must be not only in writing, but signed by both parties, then an email won't suffice. If it says that all changes can be made in writing, by email, by internet, by whatever, then the person who writes you an email saying, I agree, you can hold them to that. Does that make sense? So make sure you read the language carefully in the main portion of the contract. Okay. The next misconception is that recording of a deed, that's a quit claim or a warranty deed, down at the county, transfers ownership of property. That's not true. What transfers ownership of property is the signing or executing of a deed and then handing it to the other party. Even if he doesn't record it, he is still the owner. Now that presents problems potentially, because if that buyer doesn't record quickly and you deed it to somebody else and they record first, there could be a mess. Recording is for the purposes of protecting parties, giving notice to the world. But ownership does not pass when it's recorded, it passes when it's delivered. So why is that important? Well, there are certain circumstances where you may not record a deed. For example, on a contract for deed, it is pretty typical that the seller signs a deed but doesn't record it until the buyer pays off the contract. Now, if the seller doesn't deliver it, ownership doesn't pass. And typically it's put in escrow with a title company or attorney with instructions not to deliver it to the buyer until the buyer pays off the contract. Has ownership passed? It has not. Legal ownership has. Equitable ownership has by signing the land contract. But legal title passes upon delivery, not on recording. And that's important to remember, because a lot of times you got stray liens, you got weird title issues. You probably should record the deed most of the time as quickly as possible, but there are certain circumstances where there are certain reasons why you wouldn't record. Be on this show. Maybe we'll get to one in another show. Okay. The next one is this conception of what's called a due on sale clause in a mortgage. Most people think that mortgages contain what are called due on sale clauses, and that means that it's a little warm under these lights. You know, I've got these lights here that make it, let's see. Ah, much better. All right. The mortgage contains an acceleration clause, also known as a due on sale, which says that in the event of default, okay, or in the event that the seller, in this case the borrower, transfers the property to a buyer or to someone else, then the lender can basically accelerate the balance of the loan. It's not due on sale, meaning you have to pay it off. The clause specifically says, the standard lender clause says, in the event the property is transferred, the lender may, at its option, call all sums due and payable. It's not due on sale, it's due on sale at the lender's option. So when you transfer property, or you take property subject to an existing mortgage without paying it off, you're not obligated to pay it off unless the lender says, we want you to pay it off. And actually, if you're the buyer, you're not obligated. It's the seller who was the borrower who signed the note and the promise and the obligation. But it still may affect you because they'll file foreclosure against the property you just bought. So it becomes your problem de facto. But this expression "due on sale" is really a misconception, because I've heard people, brokers, attorneys, people who play attorneys, tell me that if you took a property subject to an existing mortgage, you're violating the due on sale. It's not really violating it, because it's not due unless the lender accelerates it. It's their option to do so, or if they choose not to do so. Okay? It's very simple. That's important. And the last real estate misconception I wanted to talk about today was what's called the Endor Assigns provision. Now, anybody who's been to Seminar 101 in real estate knows that if you put next to the buyer's name "and or assigns," then you can assign that contract to someone else and make a profit. Is that true? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. A contract is not assignable unless the contract says, or doesn't say, it's not assignable. Meaning, if the contract says seller, buyer, and then later on down there it said this contract's not assignable without the seller's permission, and you put "and or assigns," does that make it assignable? No! You have to cross out that other provision in the standard contract that says it's not assignable. Now, what if it doesn't say anything? Doesn't say it is assignable, doesn't say it's not. Well, that depends. It depends on the burden or obligation on the seller. So on a cash deal, if you assigned it to another party as buyer, and that buyer closed directly for cash with the seller, is that any additional burden or obligation on the seller? No. Seller might get ticked off that you made some money there, but it's not any burden on them. If the seller got to know you, checked your credit, and said, "I'll approve you for seller financing," and it doesn't say it's not assignable, and you go to assign it, does that affect the obligation of the seller or the burden on the seller? It may. It may, if you're assigning to someone who's not creditworthy. So just understand that if it doesn't say it's not assignable and it's a cash deal, no problem. Putting "and or assigns" doesn't make it assignable or unassignable. It's the fact that there is an anti-assignment clause or there isn't, and if there isn't, what's the obligation or burden on the seller? Very important to know. So those of you who've been to seminars and think, "Oh, I'll just write 'and or assigns' on my standard broker contract," that doesn't make it assignable at all. That's a myth, complete myth. Okay, and here's another thing too. Does assigning the contract mean that you're not liable anymore for the contract? Meaning, if you had a deal with a seller who agreed to own or carry, let's say, and he didn't check your credit, so he didn't rely on your credit, so if you assigned it to a third party, that's not really adding to his burden, so therefore, you could probably assign it. And let's say that third party closes with the seller and then doesn't perform. Are you liable? Maybe. Because assignment assigns your rights. It doesn't necessarily extinguish your liability unless you get the seller's permission for the assignment. Very, very important to understand. Okay? Or if the deal just doesn't close, period, and the seller wants to sue the buyer and you, they can, unless you are expressly relieved. Now, my contract says otherwise, but that's a story for another day. But the standard contract doesn't say that.